Yes, get up, get out of your bed. Your bus is leaving in 20 minutes. Come on, rise and shine. You're waking up to a brand new morning here in Ireland AM. It's finally Friday.
And Martin's finally back.
Yes.
A lovely tan on you.
You have to wear baggy clothes, though. About a pound of, sorry, a stone of holiday weight to lose.
Oh, stop. I'm sure you'd surprise you didn't sweat it off with the heat wave.
41 degrees.
You look great, and we're happy to have you back, Martin. Now, coming up on today's show, fans were frustrated as Taylor Swift tickets sell out. We'll have that and everything else making today's papers.
The girls in green were narrowly beaten in the World Cup opener against the Matildas yesterday. We'll be chatting all things sport at 7:30.
Shortly, we'll be discussing Cancer Trials Ireland's latest research, which aims to improve the quality of care for breast cancer patients.
And funny man Karl Spain will be dropping by to chat about his famous Game of Thrones co-star. That's at 6:15.
Looking forward to that. Paul is in the building. What else have you got coming up with us today?
Good morning, you two. Yes, also coming up on today's show, Richmond AFC's Chief of Football Operations, Ted Lasso star Jeremy Swift, is stopping by. Plus, with Barbie hitting cinemas worldwide today, how does the iconic doll affect the younger generation? We'll be discussing. Now, Deric, our weather oracle, is out and about this morning. Tell us where you are, Deric.
Yeah, well, Paul, we're live here in Kells in County Meath this morning. It's a shower starting into northern areas out there at the moment. The cloud building with plenty of rain on the way right across. In fact, that risk of spot flooding and not looking good for our Ireland final on Sunday as well. Plenty of rain forecast. Limerick taking on Kilkenny. Anyway, we've come down here to Headfort Golf Club in the Royal County this morning. We're going to be talking about the British Open. Of course, lots of Irish competing in that. The PGA Tour and the merger with LIV Golf in the Middle East. And also, we've got a little bit of a challenge on the way. So who knows? A birdie, an eagle, a hole in one. We'll give it a go. You know
he's
what
golfing.
I'm like, Martin, can't
he's
you?
Golfing.
Not a bad Friday morning.
It's all right, you see. And he's working as well.
Yeah.
It's a job and somebody dirty has to do it. That's what we say, Deric. Enjoy yourself today.
Guys.
Okay, let's get over to the Virgin Meeting News Hub. Here's Anne O'Donnell.
Thanks, Martin. Good morning. Well, the sentencing hearing of two men who attempted to deceive a post office worker involving a dead man's pension will take place later on today. The incident happened in Carlow in January of last year. Here's the latest.
This trial, which was described by the judge as an unusual case with unusual features, was due to get underway this week. But on Wednesday, 41-year-old Declan Hockney of Pollerton Road in Carlow and 37-year-old Garth Coakley of John Sweeney Park in Carlow pleaded guilty to the attempted deception of a post office worker involving the pension of Padder Doyle on January 21st last year. It was discovered on that date that Mr. Doyle, who was a relative of Mr. Hockney, was dead inside Hosey's post office on Stapleton Road, and his body was later removed. Judge Eugene O'Kelly said since the incident involved a deceased man, it was appropriate to direct the preparation of a victim impact statement from his family. The pair were remanded in custody ahead of the sentencing hearing today when the judge said the somewhat bizarre circumstances of the case would be outlined. Both men face up to 5 years in prison. Trish Laverty, Virgin Media News.
The Lord Mayor of Dublin says he will be meeting with the Assistant Garda Commissioner on Monday to discuss the number of Gardaí on the beat and antisocial behaviour in the capital. Well, it follows a serious attack on an American tourist who had just left his accommodation in the city centre on Talbot Street on Wednesday night.
Antisocial behaviour has always been pervasive right across Dublin City. But it was always managed a little bit better. And sometimes with the advent of social media, messages are getting out there much quicker, much faster. And often you get graphic images or graphic videos being circulated around. So I think we just see it a little bit more. But what we need to be doing, again, it comes back to the response. What's our response as a city to ensure that instances like this are less and less into the future?
Well, several packages of cocaine worth over €4 million have been found scattered along the North Donegal coastline. The drugs weighing around 60 kilos have been discovered in the Fonad Head area since Wednesday. Gardaí are now appealing to landowners and members of the public not to interfere with the packages if they come across them and to contact Gardaí. The White House has warned that the Russian military is preparing for possible attacks on civilian shipping vessels in the Black Sea. Well, Moscow has been pounding Ukraine's southern cities with drones and missiles and also attacking grain ships, sparking fears of a global food crisis for millions of the world's poor. The United Nations Secretary General has condemned the Russian attacks.
The Secretary General strongly condemns the Russian attacks against port facilities in Odessa and other Ukrainian ports on the Black Sea. The attacks contradict the Russian Federation's commitment under the Memorandum of Understanding with the United Nations, which states that, quote, the Russian Federation will facilitate the unimpeded export of food, sunflower oil, and fertilizers from Ukraine-controlled Black Sea ports.
Elsewhere, the Greek government is warning that the hard times are clearly not over as authorities brace for a new round of extreme weather. The fire service and civil protection authority remain on alert as a new heat wave moves eastward across Greece. Well, it's expected to push temperatures to 45 degrees Celsius on Sunday.
We compare 14 insurance quotes to get you the best deal. So choose chill and work smarter, not harder.
Yes, thank you, Anne, and a very good morning. We're live here at Headfort Golf Club. We're down here in the Royal County, just outside Kells in County Meath, right across the morning. And we've got lots of golfing fun coming your way over the next couple of hours to do hang with us for that. Now, let's take an opening look at weather. We're into Friday morning. We're into the weekend. We've got Conan Doyle with us on cameras once again. And I have to say, it is a mainly dry and settled start. You'll be glad to hear for many areas across the island. Good deal cloud cover, limited bright breaks now on the breakfast menu, although we are seeing showers in across parts of northern areas through the northwest as well in those moderate westerly winds. Now, right across this afternoon, it's not a great tale we're telling because we have plenty of showers on the way. And in fact, that cloud cover building through parts of the west up across the northwest. And in fact, that's where we're going to see the heaviest of any rain out there today. Driest the further east, southeast we go. And once again, very similar to yesterday, that's where the warmest of those valleys, although fresher and cooler out there this Friday with top temps in and around 14 to 18 degrees. Right across then into tonight, this is where the coin will flip because we're going to see that system of rain pull in plenty of showers. And in fact, some of that rain will be intense in nature. We're going to see plenty of surface water, spot flooding as well, would you believe, as we work our way into the weekend with overnight lows there back to 10 to 14 degrees. So that's how it's shaping up here in a cloudy but settled Headfort Golf Club in Kells and County Meath. We'll be back again live, 7:35.
Chill Insurance work harder, so you can work smarter. We compare 14 quotes to get you the best deal.
All right, let's take a first look at your morning paper, starting with the Irish Times. It leads with agency set to buy land for affordable and social housing. The paper reports that the Land Development Agency, charged with delivering affordable homes and social housing on public land, is to begin a programme of purchasing privately owned sites that can be utilised for quick delivery of public housing.
Letter reveals lonely life and cruel death of Tipperary couple. That's the front page of the Irish Independent. The story reveals a torn-up letter recovered from a bin has shed new light on the mysterious deaths of a reclusive husband and wife whose bodies lay undiscovered in their remote home for a year and a half.
The Examiner leads with Russia sparks global food crisis warning. The UN has warned of a global food security crisis for millions of the world's poor following Moscow's withdrawal from a grain export deal.
Onto the tabloids, and the Daily Mail leads with time to tackle the thuggery. The paper reports the outcry over the latest violent attack on Dublin streets as a US tourist was left with life-changing injuries following vicious assault by youths.
The Mirror writes, let me back on air. The story details Ryan Tubridy met with RTE boss Kevin Backhurst this week for one-to-one talks.
The Sun leads with Tubbs and RTE back in touch. The story details RTE boss Kevin Backhurst has held a face-to-face meeting with Ryan Tubridy and is planning another one after they both take a break.
The Herald leads with Gardaí hunt feral gang. And this is after a US tourist attack. The Gardaí believe the gang who left a US tourist with life-changing injuries in a brutal street attack have been behind a spate of violent group assaults in Dublin city centre.
And finally, the Star goes with Vera. We're afraid of no one. The story reads, proud Vera Powell vowed Ireland will bounce back in their key World Cup clash against Canada next week.
All right, up next, we'll be chatting through the top stories making today's papers. We'll be back with you after this quick break.
very welcome back to Ireland AM. Now, from ambulance delays to Taylor Swift ticket drama, it's been a busy morning for news.
Joining us with that story and everything else this morning is Bar Media's political correspondent, Sean Defoe, and account director with DHR Communication and former USI president, Seán Cahill. Good to see you both.
Morning, guys. Thanks
okay, for having us. We're starting with this awful attack that took place, Sean, on this American tourist in Store Street. And Store Street is where there's a Garda station as well. So these people who carried out this attack clearly are kind of thumbing their nose at the Gardaí.
Yeah, very little fear. And this American tourist at 11 o'clock on Wednesday night, and unfortunately he's been left with what's described as life-altering injuries. And you absolutely hate to hear that because, you know, someone who is here seems to come here quite a lot by all accounts and might have been here on business to happen in the middle of the city, as you say, near enough to a Garda station is sort of... No, unfortunately, I was going to say it's unthinkable. It's not unthinkable because it's happened quite a lot, unfortunately, in the city. And, you know, the Taoiseach is saying there's a public order problem. There's a crime problem, particularly around Dublin City.
Yeah, and Sheena, it's not the only recent attack. We know Ukrainian actor Alexander, who was performing at the Abbey Theatre, also suffered injuries. I mean, what can we do about this? Like, do we need more Gardaí patrolling the streets?
Yeah, I mean, look, I think there's certainly a justice element to this. It's there's a crime element to this, as Sean has said, in relation to, you know, how are we managing our streets in a visible way from a Garda perspective. But ultimately, this happened directly outside one of the capital's largest Garda stations. So the question, I think questions need to be asked about what does visibility mean? What do we mean by Gardaí on the street? Yeah. I think it's easy to just say we need more Gardaí and we need them now and not look at perhaps some of the root kind of elements of this. I mean, obviously, we have seen an increase in crime and violent assaults with involving young people and groups of young men in particular. And I think we need to look at, you know, particularly now that it's the school holidays, what are the services and amenities that are available in the city centre for young people who are under 18, who obviously you don't want going into bars and other locations. But where is there to go? Yeah. And I think we need to ask those questions as well.
What does Varadkar say about this?
So. Yeah, well, look, he said that there's obviously a public order problem in Dublin City Centre. Now, the government has defended some of what it's done. Like, there's been steps to improve the visibility that Sheen is talking about, like that new Garda station on O'Connell Street, which I was at the launch of, and that's there, and it's sort of running later hours in order to try and address some of the late-night crime that's there. But, look, ultimately, Dublin City Centre doesn't feel like a very safe place. It hasn't for a number of years. It really changed during COVID. Something I really noticed, I'd never felt unsafe in Dublin before until COVID, until I was kind of there at the late night press conferences and walking home to my car. And that didn't really go away afterwards. And particularly if, like, you think of somewhere like O'Connell Street, which is meant to be our national street, our Champs-Élysées, for want of a better word, and it's not a nice place to go down. You know, it's a very unsafe place to go down.
Even by day, you can feel that unease.
Which is remarkable. And like Sheena said, I don't really know what it is. Is it a case of putting more Gardaí on the streets? I think that might help a little bit. But this happened right near a Garda station, you know, at a time when it was only just getting dark on Wednesday night. So, yeah, it's hard to know where the full answer is. It's not just in putting more boots on the ground because there are other issues around O'Connell Street, homelessness, drug abuse, drug issues. And they are people who need help as much as they need to be, you know, they shouldn't be just shoved out of the way of people either. So there's a few problems there that need to be addressed and that probably went under-resourced over the last 10 years. That's starting to change, but it's still not there.
I think it's going to be fascinating what the public and government response is to something that might impact tourism.
Yeah.
I think this was obviously an American who had, we believe, been a regular visitor to Dublin from Washington, D.C. And it will be interesting. Are we going to see a slightly different or more immediate response from government and a more firm response in whatever way because this might impact you know, the idea of this shame on Dublin City internationally, this idea that it might impact our tourist trade. And that will be, I think, an interesting look for the next couple of days.
Yeah, it's the ferocity of the attack as well, which is most concerning. Another story today that got our attention is the response by ambulance services to different emergencies. And apparently last month's figures are not encouraging.
Yeah, you never just see a great headline about ambulance services, though. It's kind of it's one of those things. And unfortunately, you know, under the kind of National Action Plan, the idea was that you'd try and hit a kind of a target of response rates under 19 minutes. And I think it was over 60% actually were hitting that. So that is a cause for concern because everybody probably knows someone who was was waiting too long to get an ambulance. And of course, the reality here is this is about staffing, it's about resourcing. You know, the ambulance service are an incredible service in Ireland. The people who are behind it work extremely hard. So now it's about making sure that they get the allocation that they need to do the work that needs to be done. There has been an increase in calls, there's been an increase in the need for the ambulance service. So now what you need to see is an increase in the resources. Everything is going to be about an increase of resources. We're already on the lead in to what is going to be a very sexy budget, I'm sure. And everybody's going to be out vying for more resources. So this is certainly going to be one of them, because obviously lives and health at risk.
And just speaking of an increase in services and resources as well, what does Stephen Donnelly say about this issue?
Yeah, well, Stephen Donnelly said that, look, they had a record budget last year when it came to the ambulance services, around 200 million euro, and that budget has been going up. He's been visiting different ambulance services around the country over the last couple of months. And it's interesting about that health budget element of it, because there is a big row going on in government at the minute over the health budget. It's overrunning. It's been overrunning every year. Mm-hmm. But they've been sort of fudging the figures by pushing it into next year's budget the whole time. And now Pascal Donoghue is finally pushing back and saying, actually, hold on, we need to grab hold of this runaway train. So money might not actually be as plentiful for the department, which, along with social protection, is the biggest spending department in the country. Well, it's interesting when it comes to ambulance services. Like, it's some part of a postcode lottery, depending on where you are.
Yeah.
Like, if you're in a rural area, you could be waiting plus 2 hours for an ambulance
for a really long time.
So some of that depends. And they're actually almost meeting their own targets on it. I think they set a target of 75% of the immediately life-threatening to be met within 19 minutes. They're at 69% of that. And for the almost immediate life-threatening one, if you like, they set a target of 45% within 19 minutes, and they're at 44. But they're still quite low. Do you know what I mean? It's sort of setting a target artificially low, because you know that you're not going to actually meet it. So it will be interesting to see where that money grab goes in the budget.
With all those romantic letters between the ministers, Stephen Donnelly and Pascal Donoghue, I'm sure something will be exciting.
Cuddling up inside those negotiations. Yeah.
Okay. Let's move on to a story that had everybody's attention, not just yesterday, but over the last few weeks, and that's Taylor Swift tickets.
Are you devil? I got a ticket.
Oh, you?
I know. Yeah. I am not.
Amazing.
I am not devil.
Amazing.
I would like to personally thank a friend of mine, Andrew Martin, who is a massive Taylor Swift fan. And Sean was asking me earlier, like, you know, where are you at with the Taylor Swift ticket? Did you get one or whatever? And I was like, I went to the network. Like,
Swifties.
Swifties have been, like, other people go to army camp. You know, Swifties have been ready for this moment for a long time. I say this, obviously, with the fact that so many people were left incredibly frustrated, upset, or bereft of hundreds of euro yesterday and in the last few weeks, trying to get tickets for the Aviva Stadium.
So what was the structure? There was three opportunities, basically.
I think I'm going to have to call a PhD student. But basically, there was, as far as I'm concerned, there was effectively a very first pre-sale, which was for people who had bought Taylor Swift's Midnight's album last year.
Yes.
So that effectively was like the actual pre-sale. Then there was a pre-sale, and then there's a general sale. The whole plan around this, for anyone who's only kind of dropping into this now, is the idea that obviously Taylor Swift is absolutely massive. The figures for people trying to get tickets are in their thousands and thousands, hundreds of thousands. Americans getting tickets in Dublin, as an example, right? And the idea was they were trying to reduce the amount of ticket touting. So the amount of, you know, lads going in, buying a rake of tickets, selling them off for huge money. I mean, you have got people, you know, in articles today in the Irish Independent saying they would quite literally sell a kidney to get it. And, you know, it's just, we were joking with this, like, if you think it's going spare, you're like, right, if I think I could get into the arena, I'm going to use it. Like, that's the value. And obviously, we put this in perspective. I mean, there is a huge amount of money involved here. And Taylor Swift's marketing campaign has been second to none, because they haven't nearly had to spend any money on it. Mm-hmm. Everybody has been just talking about this online, because it's been such a drama. And I think, I hope for people who didn't get tickets, there will be kind of tickets floating about over the next few months.
Hopefully not for 700 euro.
Not for 700 euro. And look, because that's the thing. This wasn't small change.
No.
I mean, the tickets started around 85, 86. That's not small change for people.
No.
So you had mums and dads, you know, online, you know, over the last number of weeks, trying to get tickets for desperately massive Taylor Swift fans who are young Taylor Swift fans. Mm. And they were willing to spend 600 and 700 euro per ticket. And that is a huge amount of money. Yeah. Having said that, I know people who took annual leave days to be ready for this moment. And we laugh.
I think you're speaking for yourself.
I got a friend to help out. I was like, I am not ready. I'm not trained for this.
Look, 5 years ago, they couldn't give Taylor Swift tickets away.
I got a free ticket last time. And it was an amazing show. But literally, there was so many people.
Oh, an amazing show. But the security guard at Q102, the concierge, he got 12 tickets in the space. Of 5 hours. Yeah. And managed to give them all away because Leeds were playing at the same time that the concert was on. And his wife walked home and said, I've 4 tickets.
Oh my God.
For Taylor Swift tomorrow night. And they were handed, she was working in some government department, and they came in and just started handing tickets out. And whereas now, different story.
Yeah. Remarkable how she turned it around. And so clever linking it to album sales from the year before, because next time around, that album goes on sale and everyone's like, oh, better buy that. Get your ticket code.
Smart. She's a smart lady. Mm. Yeah. Good to see you both. Thanks for coming in. All right, up next, battling Ireland paid the penalty in the World Cup opener against the Aussies. We'll chat all things sport in just a few minutes.
Welcome back. If you or someone you love has been diagnosed with secondary breast cancer, you may have heard of Cancer Trials Ireland's latest research survey.
A barrier-breaking study conducted by and for cancer patients, this survey aims to improve care for breast cancer patients in Ireland.
We're joined now by the co-chief investigator, Siobhan Gaynor, and consultant oncologist, Michaela Higgins, to learn more about it. You're very welcome.
Thank you.
Now, for this research, it is one of a kind because it's created by and for patients with stage 4 or metastatic breast cancer. But just to begin, how would you describe metastatic breast cancer, the term?
So metastatic means where it's spread outside of the original or primary place that it occurred. So in this case, it would have been the breast as a primary cancer diagnosis. And unfortunately then, once it spreads outside the original organ or primary organ, it's termed metastatic or secondary breast cancer.
Mm. Talk to us about the survey. Tell us, what are you aiming to do with the survey that you've released on Monday, wasn't it?
It was launched on Monday,
Monday.
So. Well, I suppose myself, I was diagnosed with secondary breast cancer in October 2020. And as a scientist in a previous life, I recognised that there was a lack of information available to patients about the condition and really how to cope with it, how to live with it. Thankfully, we're living longer, thanks to advances in medicine and healthcare. But the question arises as to what we need. And frankly, there was very little information available to me or indeed to other patients. So the idea for the survey started to form in my mind at that point, and in talking to other patients and indeed other healthcare workers who work with us, that feeling was mutual in that there is a gap. So hence the idea for the survey was born.
Okay. Michaela, this is the first ever research survey of its kind to be led by and for patients, and it's got ethical and scientific backing to it. Why is it so important for, I suppose, better understanding of how we can care for patients with breast cancer?
So as you say, this is sort of a unique study in that it has been designed and has women with metastatic breast cancer at its heart. And ultimately, we want to learn what is most important and impactful for them. And we're hoping that with those learnings, we can improve and target our resources to what is most important and meaningful for our patients. And I suppose we're also hoping that this won't just benefit women with breast cancer, but we hope that this survey could be rolled out or expanded to include patients with other cancer types like lung cancer or colon cancer, and ultimately to help all of our patients with cancer in Ireland.
Okay,
Siobhan, I want to go back to you for a quick sec, because obviously you have been on the other side. Now you're on both sides of the scale. You've been the person who has spoken to people who have breast cancer, and you talked about diagnosis and stuff like that. How did it affect you when you then have the diagnosis and you're basically looking through the looking glass of your own life? What was that like?
It's pretty traumatic. I'm not going to lie. It was probably the most shocking experience of my life to get a diagnosis of a disease which is essentially incurable, to try and come to terms with that and to try and deal with that. And with the lack of information that was available, you know, as a scientist, your go-to is the medical literature, the scientific literature, and to witness that there wasn't very much written about us, there wasn't very much that I could hang off in terms of what do I do and how do I live with this, that was quite shocking. So I found that As a scientist, then you're thinking, well, how can I help and how can I advance this? And therefore, the survey, I felt, was a good way to plug those gaps and to try and help not just myself, but other women with the same condition, and more importantly, those who follow behind us.
And what's most important for you, you know, during this time? What kind of questions are, you know, the burning questions that you might have as a cancer patient?
So I suppose, frankly, the first question was, well, how long am I going to be alive for? You know, what's my prognosis? And that is not clear. There's a range of you know, a range of answers to that. And it depends on your subtype. It depends on you, your background, medical history, et cetera, et cetera. And there's a lot that we don't know. As I say, we're the first cohort of people living with this condition for longer, thanks to advances in medicines. So while I'm grateful that my longevity has, you know, is there, at the same time, it's the uncertainty of that, you know, not knowing from 1 month to the next. How long I'm going to be well for. I'm thankfully very well at the moment, which I'm very grateful for, but I don't know how long that's going to continue to be the case. Mm-hmm. Every 3 months I have scans and I'm in hospital a lot, obviously, with surveillance, etc. And really any one of those scans could change the picture for me. Yeah. And could effectively change things for me. So you learn to live in the moment. You learn to live with today is a good day. Today I'm well.
Yeah.
Today I'm able to get up and do things. You know, today I'm able to do things with my family. I'm able to come here and talk about the survey. But I don't know when that's going to change. Mm. And that's hard to deal with.
You're so brave. You're so brave. Yeah. And it's just, we're so happy to have you, to be able to have these conversations. Yeah. Michaela, I want to come to you. When it comes to what we're lacking, mm-hmm, in Ireland for critical care for patients like Siobhan,
yeah,
what are we lacking? What do you think in your expertise?
For sure. Well, I would start by saying I've had the pleasure of working with many wonderful people, and I think there's a lot of people within cancer centres in Ireland who get a lot right.
Yeah.
However, there are now more people surviving and living with cancer than ever before, thanks to our treatments. But that means our clinics and our day ward are busier than ever before. And I expect to hear from patients in the survey, I'll be interested to see if I'm right, but I think I'll hear that they want us to spend more time with them, to be more accessible to them, to give them the information they're looking to hear at the right time, in the right place, in the right setting. And I know that we don't get that right all of the time.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So that's something, there's definitely room for improvement. And I think we need to consider different ways of doing it, maybe new people, maybe it's in the community, maybe it's with new team members.
And what sort of areas are you looking to investigate and sort of dig deeper into?
Yeah, so the survey is very wide ranging,
but
a lot of it would focus on the quality of life factors that are important for patients, but it really touches on everything about the impact of diagnosis, what they understand about it, mm-hmm, how they would like information, how to receive it, as well as the important impact it has had on their life emotionally, financially, the effects on their family, their time, their employment. So these are really important factors that we tend to rush over. That's a little bit of social history the first time we meet them. Mm-hmm. And then we're rushing, we're thinking about Siobhan scans or getting on with organising chemotherapy or thinking about treatments and trials. So this really important stuff that's going on every day in our patients' lives, that's what we need to find out how to get better at that.
Siobhan, I've lost my father to cancer, and I've a friend of mine who has had breast cancer and is a survivor, and she's thriving now. Mm-hmm. But like that, when diagnosed, a lot of it to do was the questions outside of what a doctor or a surgeon or somebody else could tell me. Is that what's most important, to kind of get those, you know, you've had the diagnosis, you want to have those better discussions about life, about what the family, about future. Is that important?
Absolutely. I mean, I call it the non-tumour stuff. You know, I rely on my team, my medical team, to look after the tumour stuff, and I have no worries there. I'm firmly of the view that I'm looked after very well medically, but actually it's the non-tumour stuff that's more impactful to me and my family. Things like, as I explained earlier, understanding more about my prognosis, what it may look like, when things may change for me, but also so far I've had to give up my job. I had to retire medically. I wasn't able to continue working 2 years ago. That was a huge deal for me, not just financially, but actually my identity and my sense of purpose was taken away from me. And I feel that, you know, with this condition, it's a series of losses. And I want to understand what may arise in the future for me and develop resilience to deal with those losses, because it seems to me that every month I'm losing something with this condition. And I would like to have the tools to help me deal with that.
Well, you say you've lost that identity, but you're still here. You're still fighting a fight, and you're you're doing something absolutely amazing. Siobhan and Michaela, thank you so much for being here. It's an honour to chat to you.
And also, if you're looking to, if you are experiencing metastatic breast cancer and would like to contribute to this research, very important research survey, you can find more information at cancertrials.ie.
Lots more to come on Ireland AM. We'll take a quick break. See you in a few minutes. You're very welcome back to Ireland AM. Lots still to come your way this Friday morning.
Yeah, still to come, he's Limerick's funniest man, Karl Spain, will be here soon.
And with Barbie hitting the cinemas today, how does the iconic doll impact our younger generation these days? We're going to be discussing that.
And from Downton's most dedicated servant to the heart and soul of Richmond AFC, Ted Lasso star Jeremy Swift is joining us.
Yeah, and Deric, well, Deric is having a terrific time. One of Ireland's most prestigious golf courses. Did you see we did that?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I loved it.
How are you getting on, Deric?
Yes, team, the sun has come out for us down here in the Royal County this morning. We're here in Kells and County Mead, Headfort Golf Club. We're here with Gina and Siobhan. Good morning to you, ladies.
Good morning to you.
Regina, how long are you golfing?
About 12 years.
12 years yourself, Siobhan?
17.
17, and you love it?
Absolutely, yeah. Great game.
Are you quite competitive?
We are. Yes.
Yeah. We are at times. But it's a great social sport.
Yeah, and you make lots of friends and you get the fresh air and the exercise. Couldn't be better.
What more could you want? I believe you have a bit of a challenge coming up for me later on.
So I believe. Yes.
You don't want to tell me what we're doing yet. All right.
You're hitting out of the bunker.
Okay. Something along those lines. Back to you guys in studio.
Oh, I'd be scared if I was Derek now.
I can imagine you in a full-on golf getup.
With my pink sweater on?
Yeah.
Pink sweater. Well, they're all barbied up, the ladies.
Oh, yeah.
I was enjoying that
thing. Very, very on
theme. They're barbied up, but I wouldn't cross them because I'd say there'd be a golf club out here.
Looking forward to that now.
We compare 14 insurance quotes to get you the best deal. So choose chill and work smarter, not harder.
Yes, thank you, Anne. And a very good morning. We're live here in Kells in County Meath. Right across the morning, coming up later this hour, we're talking all things golf, the PGA Tour, the British Open that's on at the moment over in Royal Liverpool, as well as a little bit of a golfing challenge. I hope they go easy on me. It's a Friday morning. Anyway, that's all to come in and around 8:45. Getting past 8 o'clock here together, let's take a look weather-wise at how it is shaping up. And I have to say, we had a couple of showers earlier on. Mostly dry start out there this morning. Now some bright spells beginning to pull through bit by bit. Through that cloud. Elsewhere, we are still seeing showers rattle their way through parts of the north, up across the northwest as well, in those moderate westerly winds. Now, right across the day, in fact, a pretty decent one is yours, especially across the eastern half of the island, where we will see bright spells pull through that cloud. But elsewhere, cloud thickening through parts of Connacht, up across the northwest. And in fact, that's where we're going to see rain, the heaviest of it really out there today in those regions. Fresher and cooler for this time of year as well. Top temps of around 15 to 18, even 19 degrees, and very similar to yesterday, warmest through the sunny southeast. Right across then into tonight, this is where the coin will flip. We're going to see that system of showers pull in, bringing with it plenty of rain across the island, leaning on the heavy and intense side for a time. Ongoing risk of spot flooding, surface water on roads too. So if you're making a break for the weekend, take her handy. Be mindful on the roads with overnight lows there back to 10 to 15 degrees. So that's how it's shaping up here. Now a sunny and settled Kells in County Meath at the moment. We'll be back again live, 8:35.
Chill Insurance work harder, so you can work smarter. We compare 14 quotes to get you the best deal.
Let's check in your morning paper, starting with the Irish Times. It leads with agencies set to buy land for affordable and social housing. The paper reports that the Land Development Agency, charged with delivering affordable homes and social housing on public land, is to begin a programme of purchasing privately owned sites that can be utilised for quick delivery of public housing.
Letter reveals lonely life and cruel death of Tipperary couple. That's the front page of the Irish Independent. The story reveals a torn-up letter recovered from a bin has shed new light on the mysterious deaths of a reclusive husband and wife whose bodies lay undiscovered in their remote home for a year and a half.
The Examiner's headline is Russia sparks global food crisis warning. The UN has warned of a global food security crisis for millions of the world's poor following Moscow's withdrawal from a grain export deal.
On to the tabloids and the Daily Mail, Elizabeth. Time to tackle the thuggery. The paper reports that the outcry over the latest violent attack on Dublin streets as a US tourist was left with life-changing injuries following vicious assault by youths.
The Mirror writes, let me back on air. The story details Ron Tubridy met RTE boss Kevin Backhurst this week for one-to-one talks.
The Sun leads with Tubbs and RTE back in touch. The story details RTE boss Kevin Backhurst has held face-to-face meeting with Ryan Tubridy and is planning another one after they both take a break.
The Herald leads with Gardaí hunt feral gang over US tourist attack. Gardaí believe the gang who left a US tourist with life-changing injuries in a brutal street attack have been behind a spate of violent group assaults in Dublin city centre.
And finally, the Star goes with Vera, we're afraid of no one. The story reads, proud Vera Powell vowed Ireland will bounce back in their key World Cup clash against Canada next week.
Well, speaking about that, you've been texting us in your droves, 0896111111, if you've got anything to say. Mark says, the girls did us proud. What an effort. I think it bodes well. And Christine says, delighted to see the girls make their World Cup debut yesterday. They did themselves proud and should hold their heads high. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Imagine going out in front of 80,000 people as that's your big first game in the World Cup. That is
massive.
That is like such a thing to behold.
And for the bulk of the team, they've never played in front of a crowd that big. I know Katie McCabe, she plays for Arsenal, so she's used to playing in front of big crowds,
but as a team, totally different.
They certainly can go into the Canada game with plenty of hope. It's all still to play for, says Jack. Some great football played yesterday. It should be nothing to be disappointed about.
We have some Taylor Swift texts as well. Some delighted fans here. Claire says, got my tickets yesterday. Was the most stressful day of my life, but I'm delighted.
I love that Maureen says, didn't even bother getting tickets to see Taylor in Dublin because I knew it would be impossible. She's off to Paris. You did that for Beyonce. You went to every single city in the continent.
Yeah, but she wasn't coming to Dublin anyway.
She wasn't coming to Dublin.
But that is actually a very good tactic for Maureen. Like, I believe many people are on the same boat.
The VIP tickets for Paris were cheaper than the ones for Dublin.
I know.
Even when we had an act here who I remember went, the prices were astronomical, and somebody went to Spain and got accommodation, flights, and the tickets for the same price as the ticket here in Dublin.
The prices are just going up and up.
You know what? It's down to insurance costs.
People making claims after being to a concert and having a mishap of some sort. We do have one text on antisocial behaviour. Paula says, Dublin is a sad and dangerous place. I've worked on Liffey Street almost 20 years. The antisocial behaviour and thieving is rife. It's frightening and there is very little Garda presence.
There will be more Garda presence, though.
Fingers crossed in the
months ahead. You like this. Siobhan McSweeney. We love her. She's been on the show many, many times. You remember at the BAFTAs, the dress she wore?
The red dress?
Yes.
With the trainers?
Yes.
Iconic look.
Okay, well, she's going to raffle that dress off. She was thinking of putting it up for auction. Then she thought, no, if it's an auction, it's going to limit the chances that people will have if they would like to buy it and wear it themselves. So she's raffling it for €20 a ticket. All the money, all the proceeds raised from this raffle will go to Marymount Hospital and Hospice in memory of her beloved dad, Trailuck. She said she wanted to open the door for people to get the chance to win. She says, now, she doesn't have notions. She doesn't think that people will want to wear Siobhan McSweeney's dress. But do you know what? It's a beautiful dress.
Yeah. Well, hold on. The whole point is that it's sustainable. And so many people love to rebuy stuff that have been on other people. Look at Depop and all those different things. So this is just another aspect of that.
And it's from an independent designer, female owned. Like, it's obviously everything about this. You deal in all sizes.
Yeah. And she says, if you are a size 20, this dress will fit you like a glove.
Amazing. Yeah.
So good luck with that. If you want to buy tickets, and you can do so, if you want to own the dress yourself, there's a couple of places you can go.
All on our social media channels.
It is all on our social media channels. So you'll find the information there if you just log on or go to iDonate if you want to, if you fancy winning that dress. We'd love to hear from you, as you know. 0896111111 is how you can get in touch with us. Up next, he's the funniest man in Ireland. Well, in Limerick, anyway. comedian Karl Spain will join us in just a few minutes. Whoa. Welcome back. Our next guest has had us in stitches during the break. He's had multiple careers, though, both real and fake, and we'll reveal that in just a little while. But the last 20 years has seen him hone his craft in the comedic world.
He's Limerick's very own king of comedy. Karl Spain is here. Karl, good morning.
Good morning.
You've been doing this for 20 years.
23 years.
23 years.
How dare us.
23 years.
But you started quite late, which I kind of love. You were 28 when you started.
Oh, God, if someone can do the maths at home, they know I'm in my late 30s. I was 28 when I started. I had life experience and I had done things. Well, I did TV production in college, so it was always... I'd have been here in some way.
You were always floating around.
Floating around. I did my work experience in TV3,
as it was,
which is gone now. It's a pity we miss it.
Well, the thing is, you need life experience.
You do. Because if I'd started at 18, I'd have been like, oh, hey, do you ever notice the way you're leaving cert and you forget stuff?
Yeah, so life experience works well.
Yeah.
And did it make it easier then, kind of starting a little bit later? Because we were saying life experience, but even just being more of an adult to be able to focus
exactly
on
that.
Stuff.
You're more balanced as a human being, so you can kind of see things and appreciate. And then I was working out, watching other people, going, oh, yeah, I can talk about that. So you watch another comedian and you go, oh, I have a story about that, or going into a shop or something happening. Or how you'd react and be more mature if someone said you were only the funniest man in Limerick.
He's coming for you.
And surrounding counties.
That would be a classic version of me. Pre-stand-up would be chatting to people like that. Like, oh, you're like, oh, that movie, you're like that star Roberts. And they'd be like, Julia? No, Alf Roberts. That one, Crawford. Cindy Crawford? No, Randy Crawford. You're like that Hollywood star. Cameron. Diaz? No, James Cameron. Like,
there's huge conversation about pay dispute and who gets more money when on a set and stuff like that, right? I'm not going
comedy. Oh, he's delayed the children's hospital now. The motorway between Limerick and Cork, that's all tubberty. What else have you got at tubberty?
But back to your time, Republic of Telly. There was a big
That was RTE too.
But there was a big pay dispute between you and another cast member.
Yeah, I was doing. It's a sketch we did on the field. So John Creedon was on, who was phenomenal as the Bull. Myself, John Creedon, and Kevin McGarren sitting on the back of a horse and cart, and we're there ready to film a bit. And the director's fussing a little bit, and the producer comes, "Can you hurry up? We only have the horse for an hour." And I'm like, "Going the horse for an hour?" And he goes, "And the horse costs 500 quid." An hour, and I'm going, 500, like, I'm showing this on my face, but probably a little bit too much, 500 quid for an hour, and I'm working out for 4 days. I'm barely making that, right? And it must have shown on my face, because I looked at the producer going, hold on a minute, I'm doing 4 days. And she looked at me, he's been in Vikings and Game of Thrones.
So that's why the horse was being paid more, because of its experience.
But he's been typecast as a horse.
And you should have seen his trailer.
He can't get a gig as a sheep.
Don't be doing the gags, Mark. It's a better IMDb page than me.
We mentioned fake jobs because you did makeup jobs, didn't you?
I have, I've done it. I did in interviews before where it was my first interview. With Laura Ryan, who was in the Limerick Leader at the time. I actually once rang Laura when she was a news reporter for TV3. And I went, hi, Laura. I can't remember what I was asking about. She goes, I can't talk. I'm doing a murder in Wicklow. And I was at TV3 creating the news. She's reporting on a murder. But I did an interview to Limerick Leader. And just at the end, because I knew Laura for years, we were messing. I said, oh, tell him I was a Pretty Polly model. Because I have quite feminine legs, and they used to use my legs for Pretty Polly tights, or I was a limbo dance instructor with Foss. So I'm making up all this stuff, and it was all in. It was all a bit of fun, and Laura's having a laugh. But then when I started doing press later, like a year later, people are going, you're coming to Cookstown. I see you were a Pretty Polly model. How did that happen? And you realise, oh, these people haven't seen the joke, and if I continue it, they're going to be really angry when they find out. And that Cookstown reporter could be the editor of a tabloid years later.
Everybody's heading somewhere.
You make up, and sometimes you do. I've always done that. You make up a lie. and then see how far it goes.
And it just keeps rolling and rolling and rolling.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Now, you've done all these jobs, comedian, and also a teacher now. You've been teaching people.
Teach stand-up, yeah.
You've been teaching stand-up.
We've done it in schools. There's talks of maybe even going into a prison and doing it. Huh. And I've taught politicians. That's practice for the prison. But my favourite moment, I was teaching a priest, and the priest's dog had gone missing. Right. And everyone thought he'd gone missing. So that was the story. And I was there, OK, you could say this. And he goes, I couldn't say that. And I said, no, just trust me, say it. And he goes, no. And then he said it on stage. And it was like, so my dog went missing, but everyone thought I'd gone missing, which was fine, until I heard my housekeeper on the phone saying, well, the last time I saw him, he was running around the garden. He only had his collar on. And the room erupted. And I felt like Mr. Miyagi in the background going like...
Mm. You're like Obi-Wan Kenobi in the background.
The wise, trust the wise, man. But it's great fun. You help someone and give them the joy. Like, some of them only do it once.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And they just rip it. But you're sending all these people off into the world thinking, stand-up comedy, I've done that. That's easy.
You must be afraid, though. Are you afraid now that the priest is going to go on a world tour and you're like...
I'm worried that
But he might get the gig. They might give you...
I could be his alter comic.
Ringing the bell on the side whenever there's a big laugh.
Priest, I'm a priest, but I could get bigger crowds if I did comedy. Or throw in a few jokes along the way.
You have got a tour coming up. You're a tour at the moment, but you're also involved in Paddy Power.
I'm Paddy Power next week. Thursday and Friday in the Ivy Gardens.
I'm going to Friday.
You're going to Friday?
Yeah, can't wait.
You better be at my show.
I will be, of course.
When I say my show, the Tommy Tiernan one. The amount of people have said it to me, going, oh, was that show? And it's like, oh, were you? It says, yeah, Tommy, you were good as well. But people talk like that. But I'm doing a tour then in the autumn, and Vicar Street was announced yesterday for April 19th next year. So
brilliant.
Do you love touring?
I love it. I genuinely love what I do. Love what I do. I remember that was the worst thing about the pandemic, was just realizing, oh my God, this might be over now. Because you didn't know how long it was going to be, and there's only so much you can do on Zoom.
Is it good to get the comedy, the Paddy Power stuff, to kind of always get together for the
crack? That's what it is for us. As much as you're going, oh, we love these gigs, and it's great, but you know, us, everyone in the park hanging out, having a laugh. I haven't seen some of them since whatever the previous festival, like would be the Cat Laughs, and others. Might be a year, it could be longer.
Are you doing a Taylor Swift Eras type ticket sale for Vicar Street next year?
Pretty much, yeah. Well, I don't know if the rumour's going to start about Taylor being my support act.
Or have you just started live here?
Oh, come on now. She's been a friend for a long time.
She showed you how to do the legs.
You know, there's history.
Yeah, we both modelled. Hold on, when I made that lie about Pretty Polly, Taylor Swift might not have been born, so let's not get carried away. It'll either be Taylor Swift or Paul Marsh.
Brilliant. Thank you so much. You can catch Carl next week at the Paddy Power Comedy Festival as well on his What Did You Expect tour. Tickets and ticket information are available on ticketmaster.ie.
Good to see you, Carl. Always is. Up next, how Barbie dolls affect your little ones. We'll be discussing this after the break.
I could talk about that as well.
Now, the live-action Barbie movie's release date has arrived, and Barbie seems to be on the tip of everyone's tongue. Barbie and Taylor Swift.
Yeah,
let's be honest. For many children, Barbie dolls were an iconic staple of their childhood, becoming representations of beauty and perfection.
But how does Barbie affect children nowadays? Has it gotten any better or any worse? A child development expert with CodneyKids.com, Alwyn Moran, joins us with advice for parents. You're very welcome to the show.
Hi.
I mean, this is a very interesting topic because we're talking body image, we're talking self-esteem, self-perception. So I suppose in your opinion, what sort of impact do these perfect dolls like Barbie have on kids these days?
Yeah, so they, you know, kind of potentially have a really damaging effect if that's all they're being exposed to. And, you know, with their pervasive, ness of marketing and social media and access to images now that children have these days, it can be very, very damaging in terms of their body confidence, feeling that, you know, well, I'm I I don't look like that, or how do I get to be like that? And, you know, really damaging for both girls and boys. Because don't forget Ken as well.
Ken, you know? Yeah. Don't leave Ken out.
But don't leave Ken out. Yeah. That's it, very chiseled. Yeah. And
who
you
needs
know
the six-pack when you can have the keg?
No, come
thank
on.
You. Yeah. And they reinforce those, you know, identities of stereotypical female roles, stereotypical male roles. Females are, you know, kind of to look at, yeah. And you know,
but this is from like the ages of like six. I've probably got my first Barbie at 6 or 7, so yeah. Like kids this young, they're already bigger.
Yeah, is it planting the seed that will come that will come to the fore when they hit their yeah. adolescent years?
Absolutely, because you know, if you think about all of the Barbie marketing is, yeah. And we've seen, I've never seen a marketing machine like it in the last number of months.
It certainly yeah. worked.
It has absolutely worked. But, you know, like if you think about it, you know, a little four-year-old is getting the my dream house and, you know, it has all of these like pools and disco room and elevators and, you know, and it's just, yeah. And then my dream car.
See the effect it had on her. She's still waiting for her G-Wagon.
In pink as well. But yeah.
Barbie pink, yeah, though, yeah, as well, you know, yeah, it's no, a different thing.
It's an, honestly just impressive the impact it has on everyone. And I even think of myself at the box of Barbies I had. I don't think I ever saw one with afro hair or that was plus size or that had any darker skin tones at yeah. all. And a lot of kids are playing with these, and the lack of diversity is a huge thing.
Absolutely.
But we were talking about this a little bit earlier. The diversity aspect of Barbie only came in a few years ago.
Yes, yeah. Only recently. And I mean, which is great and very much welcomed. And, you know, still the main character for Barbie, though, is like when everybody thinks of Barbie, it's long legs, blonde hair, you know, and a particular type of figure. So I think possibly I haven't seen the movie yet. So I'm kind of hoping that maybe they're trying to move away from that as being just what Barbie is.
But how important is it for children to see a visual representation of themselves?
Absolutely, like massively important. Like I was saying to you there a few minutes ago, you know, if you can't see it, you can't be it. Or it's very difficult to be it and to try to be the first. So it is really, really important. And, you know, there are, it's really important for parents to seek out alternatives as well. It's not saying that you can't have a Barbie, but also offer other alternatives and really be mindful about that, that it's not, you know, just that you're not just buying into the marketing campaign, which is no judgment on parents. You kind of, oh, this is the yeah. popular toy. Yeah. Everybody wants their child to have the most popular toy. But also then make sure that you have a balance. Something like the Lottie Dolls, an Irish brand, they actually were the first to bring out diversive toys.
We picture them there on the screen.
And inclusive toys. And they really focus on, you know, kind of, there's an engineer, there's an astronaut, you know, there's little ones in wheelchairs.
And yeah.
Absolutely, societal roles and physicality as well, very different abilities yeah. As well, which yeah. is really important. And that's the one thing for me that I haven't spotted as of yet, and I am open to contradiction on this, but I haven't spotted different abilities being represented in the Barbie range as well. So.
So, look, we're living in a world that and we are opening up and saying, look, yes, we live in different cultures and there's people have different abilities. So I think they are stepping in that direction. And you're saying that with these Lottie toys, the range is there to
and
extent.
Other, you know, brands as well have, yeah. you know, tapped into and understand that actually children are now constantly cued to buy, they're constantly marketed at. So it's not like back in the 70s, as we were saying, Martin, myself and yourself.
Before my time.
Thanks very much.
I'm being picked on now.
No, I'm empathising. But, you know, where we might have been exposed to it might be on the half-hour TV programme in the evening, or if you went specifically to the toy shop. That was, you know, pretty much it. You weren't
bombarded.
Well,
it was Barbie dolls for girls or Cindy dolls for girls.
Yeah,
and
exactly.
It was Action Man or G.I.
Absolutely.
Joe for guys. So
yeah.
So gender stereotypes were being already formed.
Absolutely. Yeah, no, 100%. Yeah. And so now, you know, I have seen one clip of Ken and he's talking to a doctor who's a female, but he's like, he doesn't recognise her as a doctor. So I'm kind of hoping with this, they're really doing a whole flip of what does Barbie mean.
Yeah, they're really going to make everyone think. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. You mentioned there how, you know, if we go back 20, 30, 40 years, it's into the toy shop to see these toys, or you might see a series of ads on TV.
Yeah.
Children now have devices in their hands.
Absolutely.
And they're open to this market saturation. Yes. Mm-hmm. Constantly.
Yes.
So, parents, is it a case of you need to start policing this?
Just be really, really careful, you know, and understand how, you know, that's why I'm kind of always saying, if you want to give screen time, put on the TV as opposed to a handheld device or something, because yeah. you know, you can monitor much more easily what they view and consume mm-hmm. on the TV. And just to be very careful about what content they are consuming. So again, focus also then on other things as well. So, you know, like, I presume there's probably going to be like Barbie cartoons and, yeah, you know, whatever yeah. else as well. So just to focus on giving them other things where there are much more inclusive and opportunities, and have an open conversation with them, obviously age dependent and age relative, but also encourage them to be critical thinkers, you know, and be a good role model yourself. Love your own body. Like, it yeah. takes us a long time yeah. to love our bodies. We go through a number of physical developmental stages where there's, you know, kind of things happening that we have no control over, and that can be very vulnerable for, you know, males and females. So yeah. it's just to be really mindful of that stuff that's happening
and
as well.
I suppose when you mention, you know, looking on the inside of your children as well, how important is it to highlight internal qualities of your kids?
Well, that's one of the key things, and it'll help them deal with all this constant bombardment of marketing, is building resilience within your child. But resilience isn't a switch that you can put on at 14. You have to build it from, mm-hmm. you know, very, very early. So that's the one thing, is focusing on key things and not materialistic things or not aesthetic things with your little one. So, you know, saying to them, you're a really good listener, you know, commenting on internal attributes and qualities, so that they then, that's what they're looking for in the world as well. It's a really important thing. It also then builds their self-confidence, so they don't just put their confidence in how they look or what they have or what they own or, you know, brand names or anything like that. It's really important to build resilience within your little ones mm-hmm. so that they can manage and navigate this world, which is so much more complicated mm-hmm. than the world any of us here had to navigate when we were like 4, 5, 6 and so on. So, okay.
So sometimes, you know, I look at situations like this and I think, are we looking at our children's toys through adult eyes rather than looking at our children's toys through child's eyes? Is that a mistake that we're making? When we're focusing on the effects that it may have rather than...
No, well, there's a lot of research to support,
yeah.
you know, what we're discussing here this morning. It's not just kind of like, oh, I think this. There's actually an awful lot of research, you know, and look, like mental health research, have a look at that. And, you know, girls who become anorexic, boys who become anorexic, mm-hmm. Boys who overtrain to try to, you know, get
a
perfect look.
Well, what's perceived as a perfect look.
Absolutely. So I think it's important for us to look through adult eyes, but also through the eyes of a child, engage them with the play. You know, be present with them when you're playing. And that's why I'm saying use different. So have Barbie play with Lottie and, you know, kind yeah. of like mix yeah. and match well, and, you know, kind of have there. A diverse yeah. kind of Listen, playroom.
I always think of the story, and it's a true story. I was telling my son the story of Christmas and the crib. And I was telling him, well, King Herod sent the lads out to find baby boys and kill them all. And the next morning we had the very diverse Power Rangers standing around the crib to protect the baby Jesus.
Well, there
it's
you
actually
go.
Going to work. It. Yeah, yeah.
Exactly. Well, good oh, to talk to you,
thank
Alwyn.
You.
Thanks so
yeah.
much.
Thanks,
if you'd like more info from Alwyn, head over to cognikids.com.
Up next, we cross over to Deric as he attempts to get a hole in one.
A jumper, T-shirt?
I don't know.
Golf.
Back after this break.
Back now, Deric has been out and about on the course all morning and is itching for a round of golf.
And he's on the first tee about to practice his swing.
Over to you, Deric.
Yes, guys, it's your for a round of golf is right. Just about holy dry, you'd be glad to hear down in Headfort Golf Club here in the Royal County. Kells and County Meath is where we're at this morning. We're joined now by PGA Pro Darren Moore as well as chairperson Jacqueline McCormack. And Jacqueline, we'll kick off with you because this is a fantastic course. It's incredible.
Oh, it's stunning. And first of all, a great welcome here to Headfort Golf Club. Yes, we have two courses, as you know. The first one, as you've seen this morning, established in 1930 with the Headfort Estate, the really great heritage. And then you go across the road and we're into the new one that was established just after the millennium. The Challenge tour will be held there. And
now, can I just stop you there? Because you made it sound like it's normal that you have two golf clubs back to back.
It's not normal.
Oh, it's not normal, and that. It's just a hand few in it. But for us as a club, we are so dedicated to having this service for the community around us, for the development of golf, and particularly for young people and particularly coming forward women.
And
in
the
golf.
Course itself was designed by, I mean, you went to the best of the business, Christy O'Connor Jr.
Christy O'Connor Jr., that's who they engaged at the time, Ryder Cup legend, and he really excelled on it. It made that the course was could be established for event management. So that's why we welcome now this tour here again. It was here in 2018 and it came back to us again. So for the whole of the Northeast now, it's an opportunity for them to come and see the golf on display. And we have a number of our own people who will take part in on Monday. We'll have Evan Shipp and Ty Burns, and we will also then. There's this particularly trophy given over to this competition. It's dedicated to Christy O'Connor Jr. in 2016, and an Irish amateur leading out on it will get that award through it. So the other big event is for the top 20 will go into the DP tournament out of it, and we've had Tommy Fleetwood was a winner, Stenson was a winner. So there's big names that have come out of this tournament. So we wish all well. I have to thank our volunteers. We've over 140 members that have come forward to carry this for a whole week on behalf of the club. So it is a phenomenal achievement from a volunteer.
Can we also give a big shout out to the greenkeepers because they incredible work here.
Oh yeah, our greenkeepers are up from early morning in regard to it in all weather, and they have delivered these to courses to a high degree. But we also have our general manager, Alan. We also have our restaurant and beverage staff and a whole range of staff, including our pro on site.
Come here, what are you playing off yourself, by the way?
15.9.
She started off with 36, so she's not doing too bad. She's a pretty good swing. Anyway, Darren, good morning to you. You're one of three pros here in the course.
Yes, Derek, we have three pros here at Headfort Golf Club. It's kind of unique as well as having 36 holes. We've upwards of 1,500 members now.
And it's gone through the roof in terms of membership over the last couple of years.
Yeah, I suppose golf probably was the net beneficiary of COVID, really. There was a lot of sports didn't get to open up as quickly as we did. So anyone who wanted to get the competitive juices flowing again kind of veer towards the golf clubs.
And they're all out with the clubs. Let's talk about the PGA Pro. They had PGA Pro Tour. They had a recent merger with LIV Golf. How does that affect the professional game?
God, and Friday morning, it's a very political question. I suppose it's something that's been dragging on probably there for a couple of years, and I thought everybody kind of knew at some stage it would happen. Kind of happened very quickly, but for the likes of Ryder Cup and the future of golf as a whole, I think it's a good move.
Yeah, the British Open on at the moment over in Royal Liverpool. The Irish in with a good shot.
Yeah, look, it depends. Everything with British Open is getting the right side of the draw. I think McIlroy's up and down on 18 last night was certainly something that could have a massive bearing on the whole tournament. We've got local interest there with Alex Maguire over there. He was course record here in the championship last year on the
Irish
Coast.
He's a local lad, yeah.
He's late-time Bettystown member, one of our County Meath clubs as well.
And Shane Lowry and Padraig Harrington in the running too. Teeing off later on this morning.
Yeah, I suppose they're probably 7-8 shots behind, but in a British Open that really doesn't mean anything. It's getting into the back nine on Sunday, and as I said, getting the right side of the draw, getting a bit of luck with the weather as well.
Alright, well, speaking of that, we have a bit of a challenge here this morning. What are you going to be showing me?
Well, look, bunkers is the order today, the British Open, and I suppose, Derek, we could let you away easy and get you to hit some balls.
I know, it's Friday. I've had a tough week now, Darren.
Yeah,
go handy
like,
on me.
We're giving you the easy one. It's the one.
Okay.
It's the only shot you don't want to hit the golf ball first.
Okay.
All right. So in we get. We're going to cheat a little bit here. Draw a little line. We're going to hit the ball forward in your stance. Feet a little bit wider. We're going to get you to stand a little further than you might normally. Lower the handle of the club. Secret is not to try and hit it too hard. You're just trying to throw it out in a little bit of sand.
Oh, look, we're watching a pro in action here. Okay, demo it again
so
there.
So simple as that.
All right.
One more little go, same thing, out there. Remember, got to hover the club, not allowed to have it over the, on the touch in the sand at all. Get your position.
Look at that, look.
Okay.
Okay, right, I'm a bit of a crowd here this morning, so no pressure. So draw the line to the sand, look, there we go. Yeah. Now, you know I'm a Limerick man.
Got to hit the sand
Limerick
first.
Limerick for the
got to hit the sand first.
Okay, hit the sand first, is that it? Okay, so three, two, one. Bit of a support there, lads, bit of support. Okay, not a bad effort. Okay.
Get it up there, get it up. Yeah,
get it up, get it up, all right. All right, so here we go. Three, two, one. I was better in the practice round earlier on. Come here, where can we find you online, by the way?
All at headfortgolfclub.ie.
All right, thank you so much for joining us. Big cheer here, guys. Yay! Sun is shining here in County Meath. Back to you in studio. Can I have another go at that?
Pull that ball down there.
You should have just left it out on the first one.
Third time looking with that last ball.
Oh, God. And well he's wearing his green for Limerick for this weekend.
He's keeping it going.
Yeah. Fun.
Your texts have been coming in thick and fast. We were talking about cancer research. We had the amazing Siobhan and Michaela on. Pat says, Siobhan is inspiring. This research will be important to so, so many.
Morris says, more research like this should be done. Cancer affects so many people in Ireland. Siobhan is incredible. She was exceptionally incredible. Brave.
Like, yeah. Oh, my goodness.
Lots of people in touch as well about the very funny Karl Spain. Janine saying, Karl Spain has me in tears. I've seen him a few times. He's absolutely brilliant. And Martina, can't wait to go and see him in the Ivy Gardens. A Limerick man doing proud, says he.
I can't wait to go see that Ivy Gardens, the Paddy Power Comedy Festival, because you know, like, you can go see one or two people, one person, but imagine then going to see a whole rake of people.
Oh,
then.
Yeah.
I'll have a six pack by the end of it. Talking about the World Cup, John was saying the Irish team did so well and showed no fear. Vera is a very competent and inspiring manager. Let's hope for a win in the future.
And some Taylor Swift checks. Paddy, everyone seems so obsessed with Taylor Swift at the moment. Everyone in work was glued to the phones yesterday trying to get tickets. Absolute madness. And Emma got my tickets yesterday. I could cry. Bring on June.
Okay, Eric on the other hand said, I've seen Taylor Swift every time she has come to Dublin. I'm heartbroken. I didn't get a ticket yesterday.
No.
By the way, she's playing on Dublin Pride next year.
What?
Yeah, she's playing on Dublin Pride. The gays will be all over the city now. You'll have
You'll probably meet her and all.
Could you imagine me?
I could see that.
Oh, well, we
just
might
take us with you.
Yeah,
okay?
we'll all go together. Right, still to come, calling all Ted Lasso fans. Actor Jeremy Swift joins us for a chat.
Plus, we get a lesson in cooking meat safely.
We're back right after this break.
Good morning and happy Friday. Yeah, we're nearly into the weekend. There's one more hour left of Ireland AM, so don't go anywhere because we know where you live.
Yeah, and still to come, he is not quite manager, but he is the chief of football operations at Richmond AFC. Ted Lasso's Jeremy Swift will be joining us. Looking forward to that.
Yeah, and later, Nico Reynolds joins us at the barbecue to show us how to chef it up safely this barbecue season.
And now we have Paul. Let's head over to you. What's happening today at the catwalk?
Well, listen, for the day that's in it, the movie's now out. We're leaning into the Barbie mania with some hot pink fashion with stylist Roz Lipset. Roz, what's the crack?
Hi, Ken.
Hi,
Barbie.
Hi.
So, for the week that's in it, it is all about hot pink. Barbie, she's bold. She can wear whatever she wants. From sequin headbands to diamante earrings, we have gorgeous looks today from Fee & Co Boutique, jewellery from Fields and Pamela Scott. So please tune in for more.
Gorgeous, getting all pink.
We compare 14 insurance quotes to get you the best deal. So choose chill and work smarter, not harder.
Thank you very much, Anne. We're live here in Kells and County Meath. Right across the morning, can we say a big hello to everyone here at Headfort Golf Club? Including Double Trouble, we have the twins here, Anna and Katie Woods, and it's their birthday today. Happy birthday! What age are you, by the way? 12. Enjoy the celebration. They're absolutely mortified. Embarrass your national TV. That's how we like to do it. Anyway, we're getting past 9 o'clock here together now. Let's take a look weather-wise at how it's shaping up. And it is holding dry and settled here in the Royal County at the moment. A good deal of cloud cover right across the island now, with showers still scraping around parts of the north, in across the northwest as well, in those moderate westerly winds. Now, right across today, in fact, it's that game of cat and mouse with sunshine and showers, cloud building through parts of Connaught up across the northwest, where once again we're going to see rain hit into late afternoon, early evening. The best of the brightness further east and southeast we go, and in fact that's where the warmest, the mildest of those valleys out there today. Slightly fresher, slightly cooler for this time of the year as well, with top temps in around 15 to 18. We could see even 19 degrees there through the sunny southeast. Finally then, tonight the coin will flip in terms of that system feeding in from the Atlantic, bringing with it showers, and in fact some of that rain will lean on the slightly heavy and intense side. We're going to see a risk of surface water spot flooding, would you believe, on the roads as we work our way into the weekend as well, with overnight lows on the heavy, on the humid side, back to around 10 to 15 degrees. So that's how we're shaping up for now. A birthday cheer for the girls. Yay! We'll be back again live, 9:35.
Chill Insurance work harder so you can work smarter. We compare 14 quotes to get you the best deal.
Let's take a last look at your morning paper, starting with the Irish Times. Its lead is, agency set to buy land for affordable and social housing. The paper reports that the Land Development Agency, charged with delivering affordable homes and social housing on public land, is to begin a programme of purchasing privately owned sites that can be utilised for quick delivery of public housing.
Letter reveals lonely life and cruel death of Tipperary couple. That's the front page of the Irish Independent. The story reveals a torn-up letter recovered from a bin has shed new light on the mysterious deaths of a reclusive husband and wife whose bodies lay undiscovered in their remote home for a year and a half.
The Examiner leads with, Russia sparks global food crisis warning. The UN has warned of a global food security crisis for millions of the world's poor following Moscow's withdrawal from a grain export deal.
Onto the tabloids, and the Daily Mail leads with, time to tackle the thuggery. The paper reports the outcry over the latest violent attack on Dublin streets as a US tourist was left with life-changing injuries following a vicious assault by youths.
The Mirror writes, let me back on air. The story details Ryan Tubridy met with RTE boss Kevin Backhurst this week for one-to-one talks.
The Sun leads with, Tubbs and RTE back in touch. The story details RTE boss Kevin Backhurst has held a face-to-face meeting with Ryan Tubridy and is planning another one after they both take a break.
And the Herald leads, Gardaí hunt feral gang over US tourist attack. Gardaí believe the gang who left a US tourist with life-changing injuries in a brutal street attack have been behind a spate of violent group assaults in Dublin city centre.
And finally, the Star goes with, Vera, we're afraid of no one. The story reads, proud Vera Powell vowed Ireland will bounce back in their key World Cup clash against Canada next week.
Talking about marriage now, right? Okay. A new survey finds that 2 in 5 young adults think marriage is an outdated tradition. And moreover, a staggering 85% don't think you need to get married to have a fulfilling and committed relationship. Marriage, yes or no?
Yes, but I think the new marriage is a mortgage. A lot of my friends are getting mortgages together. That's a bigger commitment than marriage.
On something.
So you're saying that having a mortgage is actually a bigger commitment?
Once you're in the house till 20, 25 years, you're basically married to one another. So I think a lot of younger people are going for the mortgage route instead of, like, the marriage route.
Well, a lot of people get married so that they... to help their mortgage.
Tax release and everything.
But this is why... Can I just say, this is why I want to get married, is because obviously I want to, you know, commit to my partner.
He does love you, Ed.
I do love you.
He does love you.
After he's dropped you a Starbucks.
Don't you be telling people that. But I do love him and all the rest of it. But at the end of the day, to make life easier for both of us, I want us to kind of get married for those reasons, that if anything happens to me, you know, he's my person to be able to sort everything
totally
out and make sure everything
that
is okay. People are saying that 68% think it's intrusive to ask you your marriage plan. So if someone comes up to you, well, any marriage, you're like, people can find that really, really intrusive.
I'd say so as well.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, well, the way out of that is you go to elderly people and go, at funerals, you're next. And that will stop them then saying, so when are you getting married?
I was not expecting that at all.
I was not expecting that.
You're on fire.
The whole put a stop to that gallop without question. But yeah, people are. Yeah.
Oh my goodness. Look, I'm holding that one.
Do you know what? It's 2 out of 5, which means that 3 out of 5 do still want to get married. And as somebody who I was with Jenny a long time before we got married, and you do feel different when you get married, you feel more secure.
Yeah,
it does make a difference.
That's how we're going to do it.
I'm going to put a ring on it. Keep the ring on it.
After the break, we're catching up with Richmond FC's head of football operations, Leslie Higgins, also known as actor Jeremy Swift. He's going to be with us after this break.
Can't stop doing it. Welcome back. You just heard the latest single from Jeremy Swift, who you might know better as Richmond AFC's head of football operations, Mr. Leslie Higgins.
We'll be talking to the musician and Ted Lasso star in just a second. But first, let's take a look at Jeremy in action.
There are a lot of surprises happening here. Like that tiny little beard.
It's called a Van Dyke after the 17th century Flemish painter. Oh, and I think it makes me look how I feel. Chill.
How does Mrs. Higgins feel about it?
She hates it with a white hot intensity.
Absolutely brilliant. Jeremy, good to see you. Really is great to see you. And look, you know, we know you as actor, but also musician. And this might come as a bit of a surprise to Ted Lasso fans, but you have been trying to get the musical side of your life into Ted Lasso for quite a while.
Well, the bass thing just happened in the car park when I was talking to Jason Sudeikis, because I said, how long is he going away for when he resigns? Because Leslie Higgins, bit of a spoiler alert if you haven't seen it, out the bag in the first season. And I joked. I said, is he going away long enough to, like, grow a Rasputin-length beard? And he said, well, maybe a jazz beard. And I said, oh, that's interesting, levering it in. Because I like jazz and I play the double bass. And so that's how he sort of squeezed that one in. So I was plunking away at it there. And then in the third season, I got to actually play with a band. So that was very, very cool.
Yeah, that was in Amsterdam.
That was in Amsterdam. I've only seen a teaser. I was saying to you before we went live, I'm a massive fan, but I'm holding on to season 3 so I can absolutely binge the whole lot of it. Going back to your music, though, Like Martin said there, it would be a bit, it's a different take for you. When it comes to inspiration, who are we talking behind the music? We saw a bit of a clip of your new single there.
Well, everybody sort of says, it sounds like Bowie, which I suppose it does a bit. But I've always been interested in sort of art pop, people who stand outside the kind of, you know, the common sort of, the standard the standard music sort of pop stars, Roxy Music, Bowie, Bjork, Dutch Uncles, Caroline Polachek, people who sort of, like, you know, just push the envelope a little bit. And I love so much music. I love, you know, bebop, jazz, 20th century classical music. So I like to let all sorts of things drip through into me, into what I do, really.
Well, when I watched the video, though, Jeremy, I got a Peter Gabriel vibe from it.
Oh, yeah. Oh, cool. Well, I love Peter Gabriel's voice. He's a great singer and a great artist, of course.
Has this style of music always been your passion? Like, obviously, you said there you've got many inspirations. Was acting or music first? Or because this is your second album that you're releasing. Yeah.
It is, yes, that's right. They've always lived alongside each other, really, because my mum and dad were music teachers, and there was, like, you know, musical instruments around the house, and they would, like, have choirs downstairs whilst my sister and I were trying to get to sleep. And we would put pictures underneath the door going, shut up, we're trying to sleep. And then at about the same time, my mum said, I think, maybe she thought I was just precocious, you should go to acting classes. So I went. I started going when I was about 11 to improv drama classes, not improv comedy, you know, SNL sort of style. But so I was learning instruments when I was a kid and doing acting. So they've always been alongside each other. It's just that the acting has been my career, ostensibly, yeah.
And quite a successful career as well. Ted Lasso, it's become a beast. Did you get a sense of it when you first got involved that it was going to become this phenomenon?
I thought it was great, you know, and I really enjoyed doing the first season. And then, of course, it came out during the pandemic, and it helped a lot of people. And I looked on social media. There I am pretending to hold an Emmy because I didn't. Although I was nominated.
Come on.
Got nominated, which is amazing. But, yeah, well, when it came out, I looked on social media. And I thought, oh, there's bound to be people, you know, a third of people who go, yeah, what's this? But nobody did. I was scrolling through and everybody loved it. And I was just waiting for one person to sort of go, oh, here we go, another blah, blah, you know. But there wasn't. Everybody just went for it. And I think because it wasn't plugged in the same way as like The Morning Show that had huge big stars in, like Jennifer Aniston and Steve Carell, it was a surprise for Apple TV Plus because they didn't sort of back it quite as much as they did with that show. So it really was the public that really took to it, you know.
It's almost like an underdog, and everyone loves an underdog, and that's exactly what Ted Lasso was. And I suppose, talking about underdog, the making of the show had a very similar feel. Is it true that when it came to scripts, they could change so much that you actually just didn't even bother to look at them? It was a case of, throw it out the window, we'll see what happens.
Well, you had to sort of remember the loose structure of them. But, yeah, certainly for the third season, after about a month, I thought, you know what, I'm just going to look it over. I'm not going to sort of really, really learn it properly because you get up in the morning very early and then about 7 o'clock in the morning in the car, going to the studio, you'd get a ping on your phone and it would have changed, then changed again from makeup to going onto the set and then on the set as well, you know.
Is that tough to keep things together? Because I know, like, I'd want the script and you're saying it. Sometimes you're a bit angry. You're just like, sure, come here. We know what it is.
Well, it would go back and forth because sometimes it's like somebody else would have your speech and then another time you'd be like, oh, Juno's not in the scene anymore. You're saying all her lines. It's like, okay. Right, you know, so you just had to be on it, really. But it's great fun when because Jason Sudeikis and Brendan Hunt, who plays Coach Beard in the show, they are superb at improv. And it was fantastic when we'd just go off piste during a take. Yeah. And you just have to go with that. That was a lot of fun.
A lot of fun. Ted Lasso has brought you to many places, including the White House. President Biden's a fan.
He is, yeah. My manager, American manager, loved that picture. She said, great placement, Jeremy. he was great. And the First Lady as well. Yeah, we had a little tour and he showed us around the Oval Office and the side rooms from the Oval Office and, you know, where Trump sat and watched the insurrection on the television, for example. And, you know, he had little anecdotes. I have to tell you that a lot of people are a bit ageist about Joe Biden because when he was kneeling down there, I was stood behind him. And when he got up without any assistance and no wobbling. And I can't do that. And I'm, you know, 20 years younger than him. It was a fabulous day. And we got to do things like go bowling. There's a Harry Truman bowling alley in the White House. Can you believe?
Wow.
All sorts of stuff. It was amazing.
Your relationship with Rebecca Higgins in the show is iconic to watch, the back and forth. Hannah Waddingham has become you know, a star in her own right of recent, you know, the Eurovision, the all the bits and bobs she's been doing. What's your rapport like on set? I'm fathom to know.
I don't want to be part of
the we sort of loved each other from the get-go, really. And because I'm musical and she's a big musical star, there is a kind of symbiosis with comedy and music, you know. It's a lot to do with rhythm, I think. And quite often, the first time we would read through a scene, I'd sort of feel like, could you have filmed that? Because it was already good. I love working with her so much, and I could, you know, just do scene after scene with her, really. She's such fun.
I was a big fan of, and so was my late dad, of Foyle's War. And you were part of that production when it moved to Dublin. Did you have a good time here? Were you treated well?
Absolutely. Yes, we were, and I loved the Dublin people. It was fantastic. We did the next series in Liverpool, which was great because I love Liverpool. But I was like, oh, can't we go to Dublin again? It was great. Absolutely. And I loved that show very much. I was a bit sad that, you know, I just joined it after it had done millions of series and then it ended. I was like, oh no. But then other stuff came along as well. But I had a great time in Dublin.
Well, Jeremy, best of luck with the new single. And I know we've been told no next season of Ted Lasso, but we're holding close for fingers crossed, or even a crossover between you and Rebecca. You never know. You never know. Thanks so much for joining us on RLAM.
Thanks, guys. Thank you.
Just a reminder to you, Jeremy's new single, Can't Stop Doing It, is available now wherever you get your music.
Up next, barbecue food safety for when it gets a little bit hotter outside. Stay with us.
Now, it may not look like it today, or today for the last few days, but it's still summertime.
I promise.
Just about.
It's still about summer. Yes, and with more hot weather on the horizon, hopefully. Well, Chef Nika Reynolds is here to show us how to cook those smoky good meals to perfection.
To perfection.
But first, Nika, a little bit about yourself before we get into the cooking and the safety of it. How did you actually get into culinary arts?
Culinary arts.
We've elevated it.
Yeah, that
sounds a bit more special than I actually am. No, it was the only thing that ever really grabbed my focus, and it was this kind of thing. It's everybody has their own little method of expressing themselves through some sort of creation, and that's always been mine.
You like to take traditional Irish dishes and
give them a little Caribbean style, swing your hips into it and stuff. Mother's side of the family are Jamaican, so I always wanted to bring those Caribbean flavours into Irish cooking and see what the next 20 years would take me there.
Nothing like a little bit of Caribbean flavours when you're dealing with your bacon, your roast potatoes.
This is it.
So how old were you when you cooked your first meal at home? You're probably...
How long is a piece of string? I have no idea.
Probably... So you were the go-to?
No, I should have been, but I wasn't. I'm kind of lazy also, so it was more the...
You prefer to just whip out the barbecue?
Yeah, well, this is just one of those things. You can just take your time with it, you know?
Okay.
Now, I have to confess, I'm not... I my biggest fear about barbecuing, and it's the reason why we have you here, is the food is cooked through.
Yeah.
Okay.
Cooked properly.
Yeah.
Okay, we go through this first.
Let's go through the safe.
First thing you're doing when you're starting your barbecue is, look at this, right? Red, green.
Yeah.
Raw meat on one side, all your salads and everything else on the other. We don't want that cross-contamination stuff going on, yeah?
Okay.
And you've got your chicken, you've got your pork, all kind of just, it needs to be in its own separate section. And there's one thing I just see people doing, what also goes into food safety, is salting your food before, because that's going to get rid of a lot of the harmful bacteria. That's going to stop all those bacteria getting together. But, I mean, for more information on that, safefood.net. But we're going to start moving on. We've got our salads here. Mm-hmm. Now we'll move on to, I've got some chicken and sausages here today. Now, one of the other things I see people, big mistake, is putting the chicken or the beef or something on something that's too hot of a...
Every time you put your hand there, I think he's going to touch it.
Give myself a little sizzle. Yeah. On too hot of a temperature, because what happens then is just like the outside is going to get like super singed and it's going to look like it's cooked. But the inside's just not going to be cooked at all.
That's what my brother always says.
One of the biggest things I see is just it's on the people putting it on a super high heat.
Yeah.
The inside is still raw, and then the outside looks it, and then you bite in, and then
Yeah,
it's all going to go wrong.
You're ringing the doctor.
Exactly.
You're putting your toilet paper in the freezer. And you're in trouble.
Like the simplest way, and it's one of those pieces of kit that I always keep is the meat thermometer.
Yeah.
Simple enough to buy. Again, safefood.net to get yourself more ideas and get ideas to. They're relatively inexpensive. I've had this one about 2-3 years now, and it's you just calibrate it and get a battery in it, and it's fine. Or you can get the old-fashioned ones that just.
Yeah, just keep an eye
on it. And are there guidelines on what sort of temperature you should be looking for?
75 degrees.
We've seen the ads.
How much?
75.
75 degrees, exactly.
I'm going to get a gold star now.
No, but seriously, 75 degrees is that temperature where meat is safe to eat, but it's also that perfect juiciness.
Yeah.
Right.
You go past that, bring it up. Mm-hmm. In between like 75, 80 degrees, that perfect juiciness just for chicken, pork, kebabs, burgers, things like that. Now, I've got a bit of chicken here. We're going to do this. I think with the meat thermometer as well, is it's not a good idea to put it when you're doing it on the barbecue. Okay.
So take it off and let it rest.
Take it off, let it rest. But also, if you put it in the barbecue, it's going to give you a bit of a misheat because that's where all your heat's coming from, yeah?
Yeah, you got the bang off the grill as well.
Do a little corn and pepper salad here.
Ooh.
Yeah.
You like corn, don't
you? Yes, I do.
Who doesn't? You need a little bit
of corn.
She'd
have corn for her breakfast.
Don't out me, Martin.
Corn flakes.
Well, there you go. See?
Yeah, corn, that's what I meant. Yeah.
Not. So, avocado. Now, while you're arranging, it's also important, right, to have separate chopping boards.
Exactly, yeah. Look at the separate, not even chopping boards, sections, complete sections. Because it's one of those things, and especially when you're outside, you don't have the kind of comfort of, you know, your own little section in the kitchen. You don't have your comfort.
But the amount of people who would prepare the meat here, flip it over, and then start preparing their salads
and then
on the other
and
side.
And then wonder why their stomach's bubbling at night.
Yeah.
And now, can you cook this chicken from... frozen, is it important for people to make sure their
absolutely
meat is thawed?
Absolutely not. Make sure
that, make sure frost, it's, make, take make it sure out of the freezer.
It, make sure it is frozen. Now, when you're doing the reading, the most important thing is here is the thickest part.
Okay.
The thickest part of your meat, yeah?
Okay.
So we're looking for that 75.
We're going there. Whoa. We're well on the way.
Yeah, there we go.
And there we are.
There we go.
Can't see it on camera, but we hit 75 pretty quickly. But no, Kat's made a really good point because the amount of people who have said, "Oh, just take it straight in the freezer, put it in the oven for an extra 10 minutes, it'll be grand."
No. It will never be grand. Thawed out completely, and that goes into another thing of when your barbecue's done and dusted, that you want to have a little bit of leftover. Make sure it cools down fully.
Yeah.
And anything after two, if it's gone over 2 hours and you've left it outside, you're going to have to throw it away.
Okay.
That is just a perfect breeding ground for all that bacteria to get into your food, yeah?
Okay. All right. Great points. And we do want to promote self-food because it's important to all of us.
Yeah, absolutely. Especially during barbecue season. I know a lot of us are barbecue rookies as well.
Well, not this boy. He makes desserts on the barbecue. Nico,
yeah.
Same as with sausages as well.
Sausages are here. Yeah. Okay.
Now we'll have to try this.
Good to see you, Nico.
But I'm buzzing to try this. Looks amazing. Always great seeing you, Nico. Thank you so much. For more information on how to prepare for food safely this barbecue season, you can visit safefood.net. And a special thanks to your friends, A Room Outside, for the Whopper barbecue.
It's pretty impressive. All
yeah.
Right. Up next, pink to make us wink. No, not the meats. We don't want that pink.
No.
We're talking about fashion. We're at the catwalk after the break.
It's her world and we're just living in
mine.
It's Roz's world and we're just living in it. Today, we're celebrating our favourite plastic doll as Barbie hits cinema worldwide today.
And like Kat said, stylist Barbie Rosalind Lipset is here with the latest in hot pink fashion.
Woo.
Taking over the world, Roz, where are we going now?
Oh God, it has been Barbie week. Everyone is whipping out their hot pink, or if they don't have any, they're buying it because it's all over the high street. So today we're going to look at some gorgeous bright pink fashion because you know what? Pink is the colour of self-love and that's what Barbie's all about.
I love that.
She is all of us.
Where do we start? Where do we kick off?
We are starting off with this fabulous look and we went all out, okay? So we're going to go from the head down and all the jewellery today is from Fields.ie. They are in stores nationwide. This look, we had to get the headbands in.
Barbie loves to accessorize. Yeah. She never has enough. She's got her headband, she's got her glasses, she's got her earrings, necklace, bag. So we went all out. The headband and the glasses are from Fee & Co Boutique in Portmarnock, and they have such a gorgeous selection of accessories, as are the clothes from Fee & Co Boutique. Then the jewellery is absolutely beautiful. As I mentioned, all the jewellery today is from fields.ie. They have 13 stores nationwide with over 400 employees. They're an Irish brand, and I absolutely love that we have an Irish Barbie this year.
Yes.
So we had to add, of course, the gorgeous Clada necklace that symbolises an Irish love. I love this. It's sterling silver and it has a little pink diamond in it. Then we are going on to this fabulous look. We went totally bling here. It's got this really soft touch cardigan with the diamante detail here in the front and then a little cami underneath. There's just so many ways that you can wear this and it's perfect for our kind of weird summer like that we have at the
always
moment.
You need a cover up.
Yeah. You literally need cover ups, umbrellas, yeah. Back to 50. now let's talk about this. Skirt.
I love this skirt now. This
the moment.
Oh my goodness.
It is so Barbie for me because you know what? The movie, I actually got to see the movie last night, which was absolutely brilliant. And the movie was Barbie can be a plumber, she can be a doctor, she can be, you know, a fire person. So, you know, that's very aspirational. Yeah. Yeah. And that's why we love Barbie. Not because she's just this gorgeous pink doll. We love her because she can be anything she wants to be. She can have her dream car and she can have her dream home.
And this, she can have her dream shoes as well.
And she can have her dream shoes. And this is just such a fun skirt. It's really arty inspired. And, you know, the woman there with the wrench and the dungarees, I absolutely love that. Then we've gone on to this, these metallic pink shoes. Really, really good price there. And again, giving the Barbie vibes that we're all seeing all over the runway at the moment and a lot of fun. We've teamed it just for the end with this lovely bag here. A really nice size. Again, a pop of silver and gold just to really jazz up the look.
Gorgeous, gorgeous, gorgeous. And you can pick one of each of those little bits that you want if you wanted to just pick like the headband to add the bit of pink to your wardrobe.
Yeah.
Or you can go full flat to the mat in the pink with this next outfit.
Exactly. So this is, I'd like to say, this kind of like beach 70s Barbie here that Jessica's got going on. Again, we're going to start off with the jewellery. Actually, Fields will be at the Galway races and they are contributing to part of the prize. This is a beautiful look. It's very elegant. It's got these the gorgeous cubic zirconia gemstone with a little bit of rose gold detail. Then this necklace is absolutely stunning. It is sterling silver, again, with a little bit of rose gold running through and then the T-bar detail. Then we're going on to the watch. Again, a gorgeous pop of pink here. This is a Michael Kors watch and it's got that gorgeous diamante detail. Again, it is on the more expensive price point, but if you are splurging out and you're gifting, you know, giving somebody a gift for a special occasion, I think this watch would be really fun. Now we're going on to the outfit. This is from Pamela Scott, in stores nationwide and online at pamelascott.com. The scarf, you know, Barbie loved her scarves. She loved her hats, she loved her accessories. They have loads of scarves there. So we just put it in her hair, but you could put it around your neck or on your head too. Now this gorgeous outfit is actually two pieces. It's sold together. So it's the whole look is €50 and it is really, really comfortable. So it's that kind of like, it comes in black and blue as well.
Oh, gorgeous.
The material looks comfortable as well.
Yeah, it's actually free size. Mm. So, you know, it's kind of, you know, it's just that comfortable look. It would be great for traveling or great on the beach.
Yeah.
And again, you can mix and match the trousers on the top. Then again, we went all out. We added a little bit more sparkle here with the handbag and again a really nice clutch if you do have a special occasion coming up.
And then your shoes to finish it off?
We finished our shoes off again with a nice rose gold metallic. We've got the cross strap detail and a little bit of a platform to give you that comfort.
Gorgeous.
And
gorgeous.
They're from Pamela Scott. Yeah.
Yes,
absolutely stunning look. I love that electric pink. Now,
I'm excited to see what pink is going to enter the runway next. Beautiful.
Oh, wow.
So this is real, like, Day to Night Barbie. Do you remember Day to Night Barbie? Where she, you know, she was at the beach and then she went to the restaurant. Yeah, I thought this could be that, a good look.
These sunglasses are a statement.
They are an absolute vibe with the diamonds, the diamante sunglasses. If Joyce can put them on for us, please, and give us a look. They are from Fee & Co Boutique as well.
Lovely.
Then we're going to go on to the jewellery. This is a beautiful
gold hoop earring with these metallic stones. If you kind of see there, they have these beautiful gemstones running through it, and it also has the cubic zirconia detail. Like, the detail in this jewellery is absolutely gorgeous, and it's kind of timeless. Like, it's pieces you'll have forever. Again, the matching bracelet there, and then we're going to go on to this really, really fun dress. This is, again, from Fee & Co Boutique. It's very comfortable because it just cinches you just above the waist. It's got that really, like, wide sleeve. So this is a great holiday dress. I know,
and the tassels as well, they're really fun.
They are
fun.
Brings
a fun element to the
dress.
Yeah,
exactly. They just give you, like, a little bit of an extra bohemian vibe. Again, I love a loose sleeve. If you're bigger busted, V-neck is also really flattering as well and really comfortable. It is a maxi dress. It's got the tiers going down the front, which gives it just a really nice, loose fitting feel.
The bag is blinging.
Another bling bag.
Blinded over here.
To the collection.
Blinded.
Yeah, I noticed in the movie that Barbie doesn't just wear pink. She was wearing full-on sequins as well in loads of the scenes. So, you know, if you're going to the movie, go even just for the fashion. Yeah. It's not serious. It's a bit of fun. It's kind of what we needed, you know? So I think that's why everyone is so obsessed with Barbie fashion.
And you matched it with the shoes there with the bit of silver.
A bit of silver. I love a wedge. So, so comfortable. You can stand on those Barbie feet all day without pain. There's a bit where she gets flat feet at the movie, and everyone's like, "Flappy!" It's really, really funny. So our last look here is really classic. This is classic Barbie. Again, the jewellery. It's got this. We've got the earrings, which are really, really intricate. They have the sun, star, on the moon, and they are 9-carat gold. Then we're going on to this beautiful necklace. These actually come together. So you have the tennis diamante chain, and then you have the herringbone 9-carat gold. Again, it's a stunning piece. It's really, really simple, but it does look...
makes an amazing gift.
Yeah, it's stunning. It's really beautiful and really glam. Then we have this beautiful look, again, from Pamela Scott. It's the plissé dress. I always think plissé is super flattering and really, really comfortable to wear.
I love a mix of the colours.
Yeah, we've got the colour blocking that we were just talking about. I love the pink and the orange combination because, you know, it's opposites attract. And I just think it's really, really flattering, really interesting. And this is a really classic, gorgeous look. A great way, you could wear this anywhere from races to, you know, a communion or a confirmation or just, you know, for dinner. It's a really great option for loads of occasions.
What about the bag? It's glitzing.
A little clutch again. It does have a chain that you can add to it if you don't want to hold it as a clutch. And then we're finishing with the Barbie of all Barbie shoes, the Barbie pink with the nice thick platform and the strappy sandal detail. And yeah, so that's it. And I hope you guys enjoy the movie.
You've inspired me to see Barbie. I can't wait. Thank you so much, Roz.
Thank you so much.
Now it's over to Martin. What is coming up tomorrow, Martin?
Well, coming up on Ireland AM tomorrow, country superstar Cleona Hagen will be stopping by and we'll be learning how to jive on the dance floor. What? Nobody told me this. I feel gastroenteritis coming
up. God help us all, yeah. And we meet the woman behind Ireland's largest Barbie collection.
Roz, is it?
No. And I'm sad it's not me either.
All that plus Barbie cocktails and pink desserts in the kitchen. We're back tomorrow from 9. Now, you've been texting in your droves about Barbie. There's definitely a lack of diversity in children's toys in general, but I'm not sure children even care.
That's what I was saying. Yeah, are we looking at these toys through adult toys?
Let the kids just have fun with it. Now, see you tomorrow.
See you tomorrow.
Enjoy your
Happy Friday.
Bye-bye.